All right, welcome everyone to the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture. My name is Alfredo Gonzalez. I am the Reproduction of Race and Racial Ideologies workshop coordinator. Thank you everyone for coming. You know, when we do something like this, you know, where we don't know who's actually going to show up, and I'm really glad that all of you had the chance to show up in this cold night. So today is our big event for the quarter. We've been planning this for about a year now. And you know, I want to thank the staff at the center, Tracy Matthews, Dara Epperson, and Julius Jones, who are just invaluable in making these events happen. So thank you guys. So this is the third year that the Race Workshop is transitioned over to the curated system, where each quarter there's a different theme, and the theme for this quarter, curated by Professor Michael Dawson, is on race and capitalism. And so tonight, Professor Dawson is also our director of the Center for the Study of Race, Politics, and Culture, and he will be moderating tonight's discussion. Professor Dawson is a John D. MacArthur Professor of Political Science and Ecology here at the University of Chicago. And you know, just all the work that he does around race and politics, he is also engaging in conversations, you know, trying to better understand the linkages between race and capitalism in the U.S. and working on different projects with APSA, the American Political Science Association, and the Social Science Research Council. So please join me in welcoming you, Professor Dawson.
Thank you, Alfredo. Today's program, Crises, Capitalism, and the Changing Racial Terrain, is part of our continuing project on race and capitalism, and Alfredo suggested. And we're now in partnership with the Social Science Research Council and the Wright Institute at the University of Washington. As we see long smoldering racial cleavages burst into open conflict in communities and on campuses, the question of the interrelationship between economic and racial inequality is as urgent as it's ever been in the past few decades. Our last program focused on the theoretical relationship between race and capitalism. Today we analyze the relationship both historically and with respect to the current evolving racial terrain. Our speakers today will each have 15 minutes to speak, and then we'll take a few minutes for discussion between the speakers, and then we'll open up to an extensive period of question and dialogue with all of us. The order we're going to go in, our first speaker will be Jonathan Levy. He's an associate professor of U.S. history in the college at the University of Chicago. His first book, Thanks for Fortune, The Emerging World of Capitalism and Risk in America. Professor Levy's current book project is an interpretive history of U.S. capitalism, generally titled Ages of American Capitalism. The title of his presentation today is Capitalism, Exploitation, and Expulsion. Our second speaker will be Andrew K. Sandoval-Strausz. He is currently Associate Chair of the University of New Mexico Department of History. Professor Sandoval-Strausz has two ongoing book projects, the first one entitled Latino Landscape, the Transnational History of Urban Americans in 1950. And the second book project is an edited volume entitled Transnational Cities, Past and Present. The title of this presentation is called Crises, Capitalism, the Changing Racial Terrain, a View from Latino America. Gavin Wright is our third and final speaker, William Robertson, co-professor of American Economic History in the Department of Economics Emeritus at Stanford University. He has written numerous books and articles on technology, productivity, slavery, civil rights, and labor history. His most recent book is entitled Sharing the Prize, The Economics of the Civil Rights Revolution in American South. For Professor Wright's presentation today is entitled Business Interests and Race, Public Accommodations in the South. Please join me in welcoming our speakers today.
Thank you, Michael. Good afternoon, good evening. So I'm trying to finish this book on the history of capitalism in the United States, from sort of English colonial settlement to the present, a sort of big picture book in which race and racism figure centrally. I've definitely bitten off a lot more than I can chew. with this book, but luckily for me, I showed up this fall to, back to the University of Chicago to find the race center devoting its formidable intellectual energies to race and capitalism. So it's been very invigorating, and I'm grateful to have this new community to learn from. What I'm going to do is sketch out some very broad ideas about the history of race and capitalism, and I hope you might indulge their sort of midstream quality. It's really one thought. I want to distinguish between two logics present across capitalism's history in which racism has been not incidental, but really integral, and one I'm going to call exploitation. And by here I mean the exploitation of racialized groups when they enter the economic process, normally as most racialized groups do, as laborers. I think we understand the racial dynamics of exploitation somewhat well, or at least I'm a historian. I mean, we have many good histories of it, at least. So another logic I'm going to call expulsion, which I'm stealing just shamelessly from sociologist Saskia Sassen's recent book of that name, Expulsions. So here I mean the expulsion of racialized groups from core economic processes. An expulsion, this is the critical point, I think, expulsion being the economic interest of capital. So in that sense, sharing something in common with exploitation, although being a very different phenomenon. I don't think we understand expulsion so well, which is a problem because it's, I think, a worrisome tendency in contemporary capitalism. So exploitation and expulsion, I want to sort of survey their competing histories, beginning with slavery. But first, a small sort of digression on this word that's part of the focus this quarter, capitalism. So capitalism is of course, a notoriously vague and ideologically charged category of analysis. I think it's an unavoidable category of analysis, although it's too often simply invoked as opposed to being specified. Of course, there's many ways to define and specify capitalism. I wouldn't presume to have the way, but here's how I'm sort of doing it these days and how this sort of specification, I think, makes exploitation and expulsion visible. So rather than some commonly invoked criteria, the market, wage labor, private property, class, commodity, sort of cultural spirit of acquisitiveness, I'm really focused on capital, which is simple enough. I mean, capitalism is an economic form of life in which capital is central. But what is capital? And economists have debated this long and hard. The English economist John Hicks, this is 40 years ago, divide this debate between fundists and materialists. This is the digression. So the fundists define capital as an abstract fund of value, always in pursuit of a future income or profit. It's a fund that may be embodied in physical goods in different ways. So materialists define capital as a physical stock of capital goods. It's a specific class of physical commodities whose purpose is to produce other commodities for sale for future income or profit. So here, capital consists of physical material goods like factories. So I'm a fundist, but you know, why should you care? So all of the classical political economists from Smith to Marx were fundists. And after about 1870, Hicks argues, there was what he calls a materialist revolution. So neoclassical economists redefine capital as essentially physical goods. There's lots of reasons why this happened. But one was certainly the Industrial Revolution and the birth of an industrial capitalism in which physical goods, like plant and machinery, rose to economic importance. So too much, this is a really bold statement I'm about to make, but too much of our understanding of economic life. And here I'm about to complain about a neoclassical economic definition of capital, but I think many other scholarly traditions this critique might apply. Too many of our sort of working categories, our mental pictures, were really designed to understand an industrial economy. This is where it helps, I think, to be a fundist in which capital is not a physical good, but a fund that may be, emphasis on may be, embodied on physical goods in different ways. So if we put a fundist definition of capital at the center of capitalism, then I think industrial capitalism becomes just one moment, one possible capitalism. It's no longer the logical sort of modern endpoint of economic growth or capitalist development. And I think then we can perhaps get purchase on qualities of capitalism at other moments, including pre-industrial, but also the capitalism of the contemporary world in which we live, whose bleakest edge arguably consists not so much of exploitation, sort of workers marching off to where those material capital goods are to be exploited, but expulsion. Okay, that's the end of the digression. I want to start with pre-industrial capitalism, namely slavery. And in New World slavery, capital values embodied in physical goods, but those physical goods were the bodies of black slaves. So the slave here was the capital good. And as Gavin Wright taught us historians, right, slaves were not just cheap labor, right? They were capitalized labor, capital assets, priced in competitive markets. Their values determined by the expected future income to be derived from their labor, say cultivating sugar or cotton. So this is a naked, raw economic exploitation. Now here, from the point of view of the slave at least, expulsion was a sort of form of resistance, right? Sort of flight, sort of running away, perhaps maroon communities, but the spaces, literal spaces, outside of capitalist production. So in a sense, the runaway slave sort of yearned for expulsion, and why not? Right, but the expulsion here was not in the master's interest, certainly, and that, as Tom Holt pointed out long ago, was very much the point of early modern racial ideologies, to mark very different groups of people as a single race, to transform them into what Wright has called movable capital, and then keep them in the fields as a race to be exploited. Okay, so moving into a sort of industrial capitalism in which capital now embodies in new physical goods like plant and machinery or factories. So in terms of industrial sort of dynamics in industrial capitalism, let me just raise the following issues. I realize I'm being very cursory. So Jim Crow, segregation, expulsion. I said expulsion was an economic process in which expulsion is in the economic self-interest of capital. So the question of whether or not white supremacy after slavery was an example of the sort of social, political, and psychological dynamics of racism trumping sort of narrow white economic self-interest is a very complicated one. And certainly instead of the proletarian migration that brought tens of millions of Eastern and Southern European workers to American factories in the late 19th century, there might have been an earlier great migration of African American people from the South to the emerging northern U.S. manufacturing belt. Instead, that didn't happen. European immigrants, Italians, Poles, Czechs, Hungarians, entered those northern factories where they were treated at first as inferior to the white Anglo-Saxon race, commonly paid less money for the same work. But they were also, in many instances, unskilled industrial laborers, which made possible the entry of new physical capital goods, say Henry Ford's assembly line, into industry, as well as the de-skilling of the white, basically American, English, German labor aristocracy. Now over time, we know Eastern and Southern Europeans became white ethnics, earning incorporation into mass 20th century industrial society on less exploitative and more equal terms. But there were certainly racialized expulsions in the era of industrialization. I think of Native Americans, by various means, including violence. Americans shepherded Western Indian peoples onto reservations, which were spaces sort of cordoned off from the industrial capitalist economy. It's a very nasty, a very racial process, but with an economic purpose to make way, in many cases, for the railroads. Which were drawn from Chinese immigrant labor, another racialized, although here I would say exploited, group. So we have instances of racial exploitation and expulsion running simultaneously. Nevertheless, in the industrial era, one way to interpret one thrust of the long 20th century civil rights movement is that it was a battle for greater incorporation, inclusion, and integration by racialized groups into the industrial capitalist economy on more equal terms. So a battle for jobs, a battle against segregation in labor markets, to share in the spoils of a growing industrial economy. And I felt a certain sadness when I read, when I finished reading Professor Wright's Sharing the Prize, which if you haven't read it, you should, which catalogs the many economic successes in the South of the moral and legal revolution that was the civil rights movement. And I felt sad because after that success has come, I think, something else, namely the economic times in which we all live, which I find perplexing as much as depressing. And clearly, in the United States, the embodying of capital in certain physical goods, namely factories, the sort of anchors of mass industrial society, the anchors of a growing national industrial economy, that broke down during the 1970s. We don't understand so well the how and the why. But we do know that since the 1980s, median wage growth has been flat, that the mid-20th century link between productivity growth and median wage growth snapped. We know that labor force participation, especially since the Great Recession, has been alarmingly low. And we know that income and wealth inequality is growing. And clearly, capital is now embodying in new forms. So finance is one. Increasingly, capital earns income from financial asset appreciation, with things like stock markets or home prices going up. I'm trying to think sort of through how sort of things have changed. I mean, if you take, you look at industrial capitalism and you pull a name out of a hat, take Marx. He describes a model of exploitation based, in the first instance, on the length of the working day, in which if capital can make labor work 12 hours a day instead of 10 hours for the same wage, that's more exploitation. And that's one way, just one way, that capitalists can make profits. And that kind of sort of exploitation in that given set of relationships was tempered across the 20th century by unions, by industrial capitalist recognition that their workers were also their buyers, by state interventions like the civil rights movement, and also sort of ex post tax and transfer policies. And racialized groups had to fight, literally, unions, the state, sort of venues of popular consumption, to share in the spoils of a growing industrial economy. Now, of course, exploitation still happens. There's still factories, certainly. Occupational strata filled by Latino immigrants in this country comes to mind. But increasingly, it seems to me, exploitation is a privilege that capital bestows upon fewer and fewer people. In that capital, to make income, doesn't need to embody in physical goods. It doesn't need to exploit mass human labor so much anymore. It reproduces financially through asset appreciation, or increasingly, when it does embody in physical goods by eliminating labor through things like automation. Furthermore, the core logic of many emerging economic processes is sometimes quite literally to expel. So take what happened in housing. We know what happened in housing. People bought homes they could not only afford so long as the price of the home continued to increase, but that's an instance of asset appreciation as opposed to income from labor. And when prices went down, people couldn't make their mortgage payments, and many people, disproportionately not white people, were foreclosed upon and evicted from their homes. And that might be it for you. I mean, if you can't find a job, in an important sense, you're sort of pushed to the edge of economic space. And it's not clear nowadays that you can necessarily get back in. Now, of course, the warehousing of non-laboring populations in prisons is a profitable industry. And another, I think, logic of expulsion with, of course, pronounced racial dynamics. So I'm making this really bleak. And I think exploitation and expulsion in their own ways are perhaps the bleakest of capitalist economic phenomena. But I do wonder if it is a better fate nowadays to be exploited within the economy or simply expelled from it. So in this context, we talk a lot about inequality these days, but what are the sort of Piketty graphs? I could have put one up, but just sort of, imagine in your head. I mean, what do these graphs of inequality really represent? I mean, you certainly see distance between income shares, But I ask, I mean, is that distance the result of everyone playing a sort of common game together, right? Distributive results of ongoing relationships in a common economy. Perhaps, not always, but perhaps in some instances, the result of exploitation. Or does a graph like that represent a sort of shrinking of economic space towards the top and a distancing, a separation, a disaffiliation between individuals and groups at the bottom and at the top? Perhaps in some instances, the result of expulsion. I don't know where I'm at with time, but let me conclude with just a few thoughts. 1 minute, perfect. All right, so first is a boring point. As a historian, I think our need to uncover and make sense of racial dynamics of expulsion in the past to help us understand the present. Second is the question of what sort of normative concepts do we need to really capture, let alone address, these sort of contemporary economic ills. Right, are concepts like inequality, domination, exploitation, as opposed to, say, membership or dignity, are these concepts sort of capable of specifying the wrong of expulsion, assuming we can't specify that wrong? And then third, questions of politics and political strategy. I mean, should we be demanding sort of jobs, jobs, jobs? I mean, do we have an economy capable of producing them? And then finally, I think expulsion sort of revisits classic enduring conundrums concerning integration and separatism. Because what would be the point of demanding inclusion into an economy whose very logic is to expel? Okay, so thank you, and I look forward to our discussion.
Years of my life, so thanks to the institution, and it's great to see you all here. All right, so stand back a little bit and not trouble it much. All right, so this afternoon I'd like to address all three of the themes specified in the title of our panel, those of crises, capitalism, and the changing racial terrain. First, I'm going to argue that the most important change in the racial terrain in about the last 30 or 40 years has been the arrival in U.S. cities of about 25 million people from Mexico, the Caribbean, and other parts of Latin America. Second, I'm going to propose that the most significant effect of this Latinization of urban America is its role in reversing some of the basic symptoms of the urban crisis that was from roughly 1965 to 1992, especially big city population loss and persistently high violent crime. But I'm also going to allow that it may also have left untouched other aspects of the urban crisis, especially concentrated disadvantage and skyrocketing income inequality. Third and finally, I'm going to assert that if our explanatory frameworks for these developments are too reliant upon grand narratives of global capitalism, to sort of clarify, I'm not saying it's not global capitalism, but if the narrative enfolds itself too much around that, that it kind of leaves us in a place that both distracts from the importance and relevance of government policy, and also, perhaps more importantly, reinforces a sense of helplessness before the challenge of dealing with existing and emergent problems in our cities. I'm going to ground these claims by showing how they worked out in a particular place, the neighborhood of Oak Cliff in Dallas, Texas, which over the course of 40 years has gone from about 95% non-Hispanic white to overwhelmingly Latino, but with substantial populations of African Americans and whites. And this might seem like a slim read, but it's important, the very broad conclusions I'm going to draw from it, but really the neighborhood book clip is just one instantiation of a much broader trend, which you all know. Right? There are plenty of others, like the Little Village area right here in Chicago, the other focus of my book, I'm happy to say more about that in the Q&A, the Corona section of Queens, the Lake Street neighborhood in Minneapolis, Mary Square in Hartford, the Mitchell Street area in Milwaukee, Mexican Town in Detroit, pretty much everything to the west of I-25 in Denver, vast stretches of east, south, and central Los Angeles, and of course the entire Miami metropolitan area. I'll keep my material fairly brief then, because I want to spend about half my time trying to pose broader questions that might shape the discussion before us. All right, Oak Cliff. The Oak Cliff neighborhood in Dallas, Texas is located about 3 miles southwest of downtown. It was a small, not very prosperous area until 1941, when Uncle Sam stepped in. The U.S. Navy built a massive munitions and aircraft manufacturing plant that provided huge numbers of well-paid blue-collar jobs. As a result, population swelled rapidly. Between 1940 and 1950, it increased by 75%. Around mid-century, you can see the resultant prosperity along Jefferson Boulevard, which is Oak Cliff's main shopping district then and now. You can see the exterior streetscape. It's crowded with cars. It has lots of signage, well-maintained storefronts. And I went and figured out the commercial vacancy rate. It was 3.6%. Today, to give you an example, it's, depending if you're talking about retail or office, between 10 and 15%. This is almost below frictional non-occupation of these stores. Inside, they displayed an abundance of consumer goods, and I want to emphasize here that this was a neighborhood dominated by small, independently owned businesses. And indeed, it's precisely in this era, right there in 1950, that Oak Cliff's population reaches its 20th century peak. In that, it's like a lot of American cities. Chicago, Detroit, Buffalo, Pittsburgh, Cleveland, St. Louis, a lot of cities hit their population peak right there at mid-century. Now, this does not mean that Oak Cliff was good for everybody. It quite unmistakably was not. When the journalist Grover Lewis wrote about leaving the neighborhood where he had lived as a boy in the 1940s and 1950s, his was not an exercise in nostalgia. The title of the article was, and I quote, "Farewell to Crack." He recalled that the ethos of the place, as he put it, was absolute white supremacy, reinforced by old-time religion and male chauvinist prickism. And indeed, his opinion was well-founded. It was when the civil rights era came and black families tried to escape the deliberately created and overcrowded ghettos of the city of Dallas and move into better, more affordable housing in places like Oak Cliff. They were faced by repeated incidents of white mob violence of every kind, from throwing rocks through windows to burning crosses on lawns to dynamiting, thankfully unoccupied, but just simply dynamiting people's houses to prevent them from occupying. It soon became clear, though, that these kinds of things were not going to stop residential integration, and the result was about 30 years of white flight. Population loss, the neighborhood loses residents for 3 decades. I think it's important here to stop and note exactly what that changing racial terrain looked like. When Oak Cliff's population bottomed out, it was still a majority white neighborhood with a very small black population and a growing Latino population. So sort of at the bottom, this is sort of not a story of racialized reoccupation, but rather of white abandonment and then sort of repopulation with a more diverse residence. Right? Sort of a sense that sometimes Latinization is viewed as a displacement of African American populations from the neighborhoods. That seems not to be the case here or in most of the other places I've looked at. So really it's a succession from declining white neighborhoods with more diverse newcomers. So when Grover Lewis revisited Oak Cliff at the peak of the urban crisis, his description of it went something like this. The devastation was total. An entire neighborhood sunk in rot. The surviving houses were vine-choked, boarded up, literally atomizing in a ghastly mockery of the thriving community I recalled. I groped for terms to encompass the scope of the disaster. Systemic collapse, municipal cancer, de facto apartheid, social time bomb, 1,000 points of dark. So when Lewis looked at Oak Cliff, he saw the urban crisis and only focused on the classic indicators of big city pathology. That was sort of the narrative at the time. But as it turned out, Lewis was seeing Oak Cliff in the darkness before dawn. By that time, a large influx of mostly Mexican and Salvadoran migrants had already set the neighborhood to growing again. In fact, it grew even faster than Dallas as a whole. By 1990, Oak Cliff was home to 53,000 Latinos, also to 11,000 African Americans, far more than had ever lived there before. And thanks to both of these groups, the neighborhood enjoyed its first significant population growth since the 1940s. By the year 2000, it was more than three quarters Latino, 10% black, and boasted more than 113,000 residents. That's about 30% more than at its previous peak in 1950. Along Jefferson Boulevard, the empty storefronts were being reoccupied. It became dominated by bodegas, panaderias, taquerias, botanicas, fruterias, quinceañera and bridal shops, travel agencies, money transfer outlets, all sort of classic expected business types in the nation's Latino barrios. It also became home to a substantial number of African-American businesses, especially bookstores, clothing shops, and hairstylists. So the key here, right, is that small, locally owned stores had once again become the backbone of that local economy. I might add, this wasn't just in the commercial sector. Residential real estate was recovering as well. Median home values had fallen in the 1960s and the 1970s, but they began to rise in the 1980s and the 1990s, and I might add they're rising faster than in Dallas as a whole. So this was not simply a follow-on to the growth of a Sunbelt metropolis, but right, a distinct pattern in this neighborhood. Meanwhile, crime decreased dramatically. Citywide, the homicide rate fell by about 80%, from more than 500 homicides in 1991 to 133 20 years later in a city with a lot more people in it. And Oak Cliff specifically, I was able to demonstrate using the National Neighborhood Crime Study that the crime rate was significantly lower than in other similarly situated neighborhoods. Now this is not to say, right, I don't want to by any means imply that no problems remained in Dallas or that no problems remained in other parts of urban America. They unmistakably have. Indeed, the end of urban depopulation has often given way to something like the opposite condition, some sort of scramble for real estate, but affordable housing is incredibly hard to come by. Likewise, the sharp decline in crime has not prevented the rise of shocking, horrifying examples of police and private killings, especially of black people. You'd expect that with falling crime, law enforcement would feel less afraid all the time, but indeed that simply hasn't been the case. My claim here about what's going on is a bit more limited. Right? From the standpoint of urban America and the well-being of cities, people are simply no longer, after about the mid-1990s, saying that big cities were done for and that they and the remaining populations faced a future of further abandonment and rampant crime. The big question then is, well, all right, how to explain this? How do we narrate the dramatic turnaround in the fortunes of big cities? The most influential framework for understanding this is as a part of global economic restructuring. Right? So in this story, restraints on capital are removed in the 1980s. Certain cities become strategic loci of command and control of the worldwide economy. Financial and corporate executives and the professionals who service them move to cities. And then and only then are migrants from the global south brought in to babysit these people's kids, clean their houses, and empty their trash baskets at the office. Now this approach, which we're back to Saskia Sassen once again, right, is brilliant and deservedly influential. But empirically, there are key places where it doesn't quite get the story exactly right. There are problems with chronology, with geography, with representation of the labor sector. But what I want to focus on today is the role of state actors in shaping the migrations that have transformed the nation's cities. I think the first thing to remember is that this is a transnational process. Right? The 25 million people who moved to American cities from Latin America did so only as a part of the larger urbanization of the region. The demographers Miguel Villa and Jorge Rodriguez have estimated that between 1950 and 2000, 250 million people moved to or were born in Latin American cities, which is how, you know, Santo Domingo gets from, I think, 185,000 to 1.9 million, Mexico City from, I think, 3 million to 19 million. There are many such examples. But we have to remember that this was encouraged by state action, especially in the countries that sent the most people to this one. In Mexico, the era of import substitution industrialization was specifically about creating a certain kind of economic independence by subsidizing urban wages at the expense of the rural agricultural sector. In Puerto Rico and the Dominican Republic, there were also determined programs to move people into towns and cities from their previous residences in rural areas. So the movement of agricultural workers, I mean, this is, I guess, a kind of expulsion as well, is unmistakably underwritten not just by the needs of capital, which are unmistakably operative there, but also by government policy. So what I'm trying to suggest then is that this repopulation of US cities is a process that, for most intents and purposes, begins in Latin America, and only later do these rural migrants extend the range of their rural to urban migration to include cities outside of Latin America. The timing of this transition also had to do with state action. Right? And here we have a University of Chicago tie-in, because when the Chicago boys get their economic educations here and go back to Chile and other places in Latin America, and they persuade policymakers there to end that era of import substitution industrialization in favor of export-oriented industrialization, that reduces substantially urban growth. Right? So the period of massive urbanization in Latin America is sort of 1950 to 1980. It's very, very fast, enormous. 1980 to the present, it's still growing, but much more slowly. So as a result, the carrying capacity of cities is reduced. And a lot of people who would have migrated out of those desperately poor agricultural areas are no longer migrating to Latin American cities, but to US cities instead. And indeed, you also see that people who are already living in Latin American cities, as those public sectors are slashed by the sort of neoliberal ideology of the New Guard, their livings are being severely damaged, and a lot of them move as well. So if you look at the timing, the class composition, the geography of a lot of these emigrations or migration to the US, you find that they follow very closely these sort of moments of state policy. The policies of the US government on labor migration are too extensive to detail now in my remaining 3 or so minutes, but just briefly I want to touch upon one classic example, the Immigration Reform and Control Act of 1986, which has taken its place in the bestiary of conservative, or the conservative bestiary of horror. It's the worst thing that was ever done. And so there are, I guess, two aspects that I think we need to focus on. One is well known, that the massive increase in border security makes crossing harder, more dangerous, more expensive, people do it a lot less. So a lot of migrantes are essentially locked into the United States, and they begin to settle increasingly in cities where the wages are better. So that's sort of part of the larger story of the urbanization of Latinos in this country. I think the other that I want to mention is la amnistía, right? The amnesty proportion of that that is really the source of these conservative horrors, is that about 3 million people have their status regularized, and that is a major influence on how they behave in their adopted neighborhoods. Just to give you one quotation, Gloria Rubio, no relation, an undocumented Salvadoran who opened her first restaurant in Oak Cliff and now owns 12 of those across the Dallas-Fort Worth Metroplex. When I asked her, and it's sort of an open question, you know, were there any important moments in that sort of Latinization of Oak Cliff? And she said, the key was when they passed the amnesty for so many people. And we started investing, started buying homes, started opening second businesses, third businesses. And so all these people, just like us, that's what they did. And that's what made Oak Cliff improve. I could also, just the last example I want to mention, is that of another Mexican government policy, which is that of matching funds for migrants who want to send money home to build infrastructure in their hometowns. So essentially, in 1992, the state governor of Zacatecas establishes dos por uno. So for every dollar that a Zacatecan migrant sends back, the state and county, basically government, provides $1 each to build things like sort of restoring churches, plazas, electrification, potable water, road paving, etc. And this policy starts as very successful, and it's adopted nationwide in 2002 as Desporuno, so the federal government in Mexico throws in. And over the following 12 years, they managed to invest about $1 billion in these small towns whence a lot of these migrants came in the rural, I guess, part of that. Then a whole bunch of other governments in Latin America adopt precisely the same policies, right? So El Salvador, Colombia, Ecuador, Guatemala, Nicaragua, And so by enlisting transnational migrants in local improvements, this policy really formalizes this massive exchange of people, money, and construction that links communities across the Americas and throughout the range of big cities to very small pueblos. So the revitalization of U.S. neighborhoods and Latin American urban places is again in part fostered by Mexican government policy. So in conclusion, let me make clear that I don't want to sound too sanguine about this entire process, right? At the human scale, it has often happened, really come at great cost to the people involved, right? These immigrants and migrants have endured low pay at work. They've been subject to outright wage theft by their employers. About 40% of them report wage theft. They've suffered elevated rates of employment-related injury and death. Their kids are channeled into schools that are underfunded and overcrowded, and they've been repeatedly, and most currently, demonized by cynical politicians. Moreover, systemically, this has by no means resolved key problems of capitalism in post-industrial urban settings, right? The hollowing out of the middle class and the division of society into low-wage and high-salary earners has continued. Indeed, predatory capitalism may have worsened from the targeting of subprime mortgages to people of color in the previous decade to the recently reported use of shell corporations to simply rob poor people of their homes. That said, though, from the standpoint of creating urban neighborhoods that people of many backgrounds can live and work in, the accomplishments of these migrantes are substantial. Right? And I'd also add, not just of these migrantes, but of newcomers from all around the world. This is just really the Spanish-speaking portion of a much larger story. It nonetheless constitutes a meaningful improvement in the nation's landscape, and one that we could build upon if we could just get the policy right. Thank you.
Somehow I was picturing myself as the first speaker. So what I might ask you to do is, since I'm not going to, in my 15 minutes, comment on the very interesting presentation, just please put those two aside. With me, imagine about the first speaker. And the word I got was we should speak based on our expertise, and my expertise is economic history. So I wanted to also, I knew of Andrew's earlier work on the subject of public accommodations, hotels, so I thought maybe that would be part of the agenda. I'll make it part of the agenda, and we can then discuss it later. I'm going to talk about public accommodations, which is an issue about the South in the 1960s. It's distinctive to the South, because only the South had a explicitly codified arrangement of segregation. Every other state had passed a public accommodation law. Illinois goes back to 1885. I don't say they were all well enforced, but I do say that it's an entirely different history, so the spotlight in the 60s was in the South. And here's the main proposition that I want to put forward, which I think bears on the broad theme about race and capitalism, which is that I argue that segregation, by which it was just really a kind of euphemism for exclusion of my customers, was a business decision. How often do we hear that it was so much easier to break down the barriers in the South because it was de jure segregation, segregation by law, and it was much tougher to deal with de facto segregation in the North? I think that is false. Yes, there were segregation laws in the South, and yes, they were important, but the public accommodation issue in the 1960s was not about segregation laws. The businesses involved had the choice, by and large, to change their ways, and they chose not to. Legal constraints were rarely binding, and rarely were they at the behest of mobs gathering outside. You want to know, who am I playing off here? I'm playing off the Chicago School of Economics that was mentioned earlier. The big name there would be the late Gary Becker. But on the particular issues that I'm dealing with today, I think Richard Epstein would be a more direct participant. they really argue that free enterprise left to its own devices would have broken down the segregation barriers, and I think that's false. There's a couple of quotes that are put before you that the prevailing belief before the 1960s was that African Americans on Main Street lowered property values. And in Greensboro, North Carolina, the site known as the first sit-in in January 1960, it wasn't really the first sit-in, but it was the one that took off. Those business leaders really thought that this movement was economically threatening. They did not welcome the opportunity to bring in new customers. And that quote there, the fear, this is after months of study by a business-oriented group, they concluded desegregation would make a kind of ghetto out of this section of the city. So what are they talking about? They are talking about the idea that bringing in black customers is going to drive out white customers. Now this is, on my screen this was very legible. It's one historical document that I love to show, and now I'm not showing it very well, because it's a document that I brought back from the small town of Warrenton, North Carolina in the summer of 1963, a boycott campaign that was going on there. I could read it for you if I can read it on my own screen. Most of what I'm talking about is going to be about the cities, and Warrenton is not a big city, but the appeal that's going on here I think has some lessons that are much broader. I love the rhetoric. All citizens who truly believe in a real democracy wherein all citizens have an equal opportunity to employment and full enjoyment of all services of any sort. I'm talking about public accommodations. You may think that's a fairly minor issue. In its day, it was the hot button issue of the nation. And it was closely tied to a demand for jobs providing those services. In Warrenton, it took public the jobs, if anything, took public billing. If you can read in the interior, it talks about fountain service. There is a demand for fountain service. A lot of young people don't know what that means. What it means is sitting up on a counter and ordering something like a cherry Coke or something. And that's what black people could not do. But it's also talking about jobs. So this public accommodations issue was meant to represent a lot more than a demand for a hamburger and a Coca-Cola. It was supposed to be an entry into the American way. So here are the four guys from Gainsborough. Nobody put them up to this, but it was in the air. I said it wasn't really the first sit-in in Nashville. Nashville really has a better claim. They went to the big-name civil rights leaders there, approached the business groups there, proposing that they might want to desegregate, and they said, in all goodwill, sorry, we think we would lose more from the white customers we would lose than we would gain from the black customers. That's what I mean when I say it was a business decision. They considered business decision both at the level of the individual enterprise and at the level of a kind of a business group in a downtown area. The business response in every case that I know of was, well, there was a debate about how to respond. But the debate was, should they wait them out? Here's the sign, fountain closed in interest of public safety. Or should we lock them up? Business response too. Not for violating segregation laws, but for trespassing. And that was the issue. The Supreme Court never really settled it. Was trespassing, see, the whole issue had to do, the legal issue had to do with state action. Certainly as of the Brown decision in 1954, state action to enforce segregation was illegal. But the last defense here was the right of a private business proprietor to make their own decisions about who to serve and who not to serve. And the trespassing was an acceptable law, but the legal issue was enforcing a trespassing law for the purpose of enforcing segregation. Was that going to be illegal? And the Supreme Court never had the nerve. By and large, they let the sit-inners get off, but they never had the nerve to quite. It required the Civil Rights Act of 1964. What is it that turned the tide? The fact that this waiting out strategy wasn't working. They were losing money. These are headlines from Women's Wear Daily. You do interesting reading when you get into this line. Women's Wear Daily, but it has a lot of good material. Negro protests plagued chains, no end in sight. Retail losses cited Negro sit-downs, spread his fear. Boycott hurts in Nashville, and they could go on and on. So against their better judgment, very reluctantly, and often under the cover of a no publicity agreement, in
from place after place, they decided to go along, fearing the worst. What happened was, hey, it wasn't so bad. There's a food counter worker. I wouldn't have believed it. There's not one word been said between a white customer and a Negro in my hearing, not one. And a manager who had stuck it out for 4 months thinking he was doing the right thing economically speaking, if I'd known it could have been done this easily, I'd have been for it right from the start. I'm not saying this was the same everywhere. You might say, yeah, this is the Upper South. These are not the worst incorrigible cases. That's true. But I think in most of the big cities, this was the experience. So this is very interesting from the standpoint of economic history. Normally, we talk about business groups pursuing public policy as a way of pursuing their own economic ends. Here's a case where business groups didn't understand their own best self-interest because their vision was constrained by their racialized attitudes. So what I present in the book is a series of charts like this. Dallas was one of the early desegregators. 1961, and what I put before you here is evidence on retail sales, which were tracked by the Federal Reserve as a business cycle indicator. It is not the kind of precise, rigorous event study that an econometrician might want, but I think the evidence is pretty clear that after desegregation, they did better than ever. Okay, Dallas, you think that's a provider. Dallas, in fact, was part of the Old South. It was as segregated as any place else, but all right, you don't like Dallas? How about Little Rock? Little Rock, for sure. You might have thought they would have learned their lesson from the schools crisis they had in the late 50s, but when the first sit-ins came along, same response, lock them up. And by and large, not only did they have that no-nonsense response, in many places it worked. It appeared to be working in Little Rock, but of course, one way or another, sit-ins and really the boycotts were probably more important, black boycotts of white-owned businesses or downtown businesses. So that in January of 1963, and when I said under cover of darkness, they were so fearful of the outcome, they said, please, they had no publicity, this won't be reported in the press. They thought somehow, if the word didn't get out, it wouldn't hurt so bad. It was so successful that by June, they had moved on from lunch counters to theaters, and late in 1963, in Jet magazine, Little Rock was declared one of the most fully desegregated cities in the South. Now, this view of things, the view that you could put across an enlightened business self-interest, was certainly what the Kennedy administration was hearing. And so they were monitoring the success of desegregation in 566 southern cities. You're getting into some pretty small towns if you have 566. So these are the Oberdorfer files. You can find them. Actually, they're online now. I did all this hard work in the archive, and now it's online. It's a de-skilling technological change. But nonetheless, here's what I came up with. They found two things. One is there was fairly steady progress. You're getting, this is from May 22nd, 1963, to July 2nd, 1964. But the progress was slowing down, and it was slowing down well before 100% compliance. And what they realized was, it's working, but it's not working well enough. They thought that they could avoid heavy-handed federal regulation, but in the end they couldn't. There's a quote from the files, reports of progress in desegregation of privately owned public facilities show virtually no breakthrough since the middle of October. Very little change is now taking place. Furthermore, partial segregation, they were learning, was almost worse than no desegregation at all, because you get a curious patchwork pattern of desegregation. Lunch counters most, hotels least, four wall theaters, yes. I mean, a big economic cost here was, you know whether you can get into some place or not, and do you really want to go in and ask? It's almost worse than when you have partial desegregation. Here was a turning point of sorts. Editorial in a journal called Chainstore Age saying that a federal law prohibiting racial discrimination in retail outlets would be helpful to retailers would seem to be rather obvious. This is in a journal that had never commented on this issue whatsoever. Now they're saying it's obvious, but read that last text, I won't read it for you. They're saying partial desegregation is going to be worse than nothing. We don't want to have a narrowly drafted law, which is what the Kennedy administration had in mind. As of June 63, it only applies within a certain distance of interstate highways. You're going to invoke the Commerce Clause about this. They say, no, we don't want that, because that's going to leave us with an integrated section and a still segregated section, and that's going to be bad. We all have to do it. It became a coordination problem. Even in Atlanta, the city that bragged that it was the city too busy to hate, a truly horrible slogan if you stop it. Take it literally. But Atlanta Mayor Ivan Allen said, everything I tried in those areas had failed. There have been endless meetings. No enforcement, no credibility, that things would break up. So what he is saying is, yes, there's an enlightened business self-interest, but they needed big-time federal legislation to make the leap. Okay? And assisting them in making this leap were the fact that, as reported in the Wall Street Journal, the black civil rights community in the South were already, the day the legislation was passed, to go right in there and test those cases. So that it was not just going to be a hit or miss thing. And if somebody wants a dissertation topic, presumably a history student, here's one I've been recommending, but no one's taken me up. The Department of Justice files on the enforcement of the public accommodations issues, which are in the National Archives in Washington, Maryland. These are rich stories because you're getting interviews of the immediate reaction of these incidents. There certainly were incidents, but look where they were happening. This is on a per capita basis, not in Birmingham, in the big cities, not in any city you've probably ever heard of. By and large, the business communities had made their peace with desegregation already by 1963, so that when this legislation was going through in 64, and the big thinkers, Adam Clayton Powell, said this has no chance, they were wrong. I don't think you should say the business community engineered the whole thing, but they went along with it. Although certainly there were enforcement problems, but what cannot be denied is complaints dwindled over time. The great influx, that's the red line there, of complaints. By and large, this was old news by the 70s. So much so that that's why they're in the National Archives. It was a success. It was a success for the moral issue, for the inclusion issue, but it was also a success for Southern business. So here's a graph of retail sales in the South of general merchandise divided by the U.S. total. You can see it's growing until 1960. During the 5 years of crisis, 60 to 65, it was declining, and then it takes off again. Enlightened self-interest prevailed. Well, he was one of the organizers, head of the President's Committee on Civil Rights, a celebratory dinner. He talked about, here was the recipe that worked. Here's how we convinced them. You acknowledge their fear that unilateral desegregation would be economic suicide. He pointed to his own investments in Charlotte, Savannah. So this is one guy. Okay, we've done it. Hasn't been hurt. You can do it too. And then that last one. He called their attention to the fact that Negroes did not crowd into public accommodations once they were given the right to use them, but quite to the contrary, used public accommodations much less than would be expected. Yes. Now, there was James Farmer and other civil rights people were at this dinner, and they did not react kindly to this. It's going to be successful because we didn't have too many of them. But you can see the difference between a civil rights leader's perspective and this businessman-to-businessman perspective. Once it's over, what do? You've gone along, you begin to rewrite your own history. I like this quote from Bill Chafe's book on civilities and civil rights. Hal Seaver, coming into Greensboro, when I first got to Greensboro, I heard the white power structure condemning the sit-in demonstrators as if they were subversives. 5 years later, I heard the mayor of the city brag about the fact that we were the home of the nation's first sit-in, as if we had invented the electric light bulb. You can deplore the hypocrisy, or you can say, well, this is capitalism at work. I'm going to stop there. Let me make a concluding statement. You might say, Derrick Bell, statement that, nothing ever has really been good done for the black people of America unless it served the interest of some major white interest group to do so. And maybe he's right. But here's a case where it served the interests of a major white interest group, and yet that white interest group had to be shown the way, shown that there's another way of looking at things, and they had to get the alliance. The big national companies like Woolworths, their first reaction was not to go in there. And they themselves were desegregated elsewhere, but they said, no, we have to respect local customs. And they understood that as related to the profit incentives. I'm not really presenting this as any kind of general formula for how to respond to capitalism, but I do think the success here crucially depended on aligning the economic interests of major economic groups with the interests of the civil rights group. I took both, plus some enforcement from the federal government. And probably the clearest analogy, in the middle of all these horrible times we're going through in terms of politics, so it seems, the gay rights movement has had such striking success, and this is what I've been called upon to comment. What are the analogies between civil rights and gay rights? Well, they're pretty striking. But the big difference is that in the case of gay rights, these big companies have gay employees that they know are gay, that they value, that they want to make a gesture towards, whereas the big companies, whether Southern or Northern, back in the 60s, had virtually no black employees in prominent positions, and so for them it was all kind of uncharted waters. I'm sure my time is up, so I'm going to hit the escape button and
given the time we have, I think we'll go straight to the audience for questions.
Question. It's a kind of a friendly critique. And it has nothing to do with the identity of the panelists, but the conceptualization of the problem. And it strikes me as odd that in thinking about race and capitalism, other than women's wear daily, sex, the household, the home, issues of reproduction are outside the purview of this analysis. And so I know everybody can't do everything all the time, but I wonder if any of the panelists would want to think about issues of public and private, who's using spitty space, what expulsion and exploitation means around issues that don't just affect people by dint of race difference, but also how power relations of sex figure in this, because its absence, guys, is pretty striking.
I'm happy to take that one up. This is primarily in the sociological and anthropological literature on migrants, but one of the first things that happens is that gender roles are immediately renegotiated. Right? There's sort of literature on ranchero masculinity, right? Sort of northern and central Mexican small town men have fairly traditional notions of gender roles. And upon moving to the United States and then being joined by their family, there are many ways it can be renegotiated. And it's pretty complex because there are variants like the wife who says, you know, we're living in this new country, I want more rights and responsibilities, and that's the way it's going to be. There's also the a different way of getting there, that some women will sort of accede to certain kinds of male dominance in the home but pile up a whole lot of economic power. So there's a terrific literature that I'd be happy to give the citations on, but a lot of people are explaining precisely that because it's a huge deal. The other thing I should add is that one of the big factors in the, you know, we're now at roughly net zero migration from Mexico, is the average number of children a Mexican woman has fallen by more than half. Right, so that's a renegotiation of the fundamental fact of reproduction of the population, that there simply aren't as many Mexicanos because women are not having so many kids.
So, I mean, in all three of your discussions, I mean, you are engaging this question of capitalism in various ways. Obviously, not everybody's going for a Marxist analysis of capitalism, but I'm going to bring it up for a moment.
Sure.
Okay. In a certain way, one thinks about one of you asked Professor Levy, I think it was you first, like what your question centered around what is capital in a certain sense. A lot of people would say that capital in the sense you're suggesting it is a kind of unit of commensuration. You know, it is a means through which something becomes something else. Now, in a lot of discussions about race and capitalism, or race and Marxism, for instance, like race sort of becomes recruited to that units of commensuration to a certain degree. But all three of you dealt with that in very different ways. Professor Wright, you kind of suggested that, you know, the relationship is kind of arbitrary. So in a certain sense, race can be recruited very much to justify capitalism, as we've seen with situations like slavery and all of that throughout history. But it can also become recruited to sort of a civil rights movement. So there's an arbitrariness to that that some might sort of feel sort of is problematic and sort of disrupts the intersectionality with something like race and gender and all of these other sorts of things. Professor Strauss-Sandoval, you suggested that there's a kind of dissatisfaction with the sort of more derivative discourse of like, well, you know, neoliberalism, it's just a thing, and you want to sort of add some specificity to it. But there is still a unit of commensuration at play in there. And I'm not exactly sure what that unit of commensuration was in your analysis. And then finally, Professor Levy, you suggested that that unit of commensuration changes, but you didn't quite suggest what that change was, you know, through your historical analysis. I wonder if you guys could talk about that.
I probably the least to say on it, but let me just kind of, your characterization is approximately right, but I don't want to make the claim race is entirely arbitrary. But I'm reacting to or playing off against the idea, well, racial attitudes, racial discrimination is strictly a matter of a personal preference. It's a matter of taste, like any other taste. And I think it's important to realize that at the level of behavior, racial attitudes have changed. Well, have they changed deep down inside? I don't know. I'm only an economist. But they have changed at the level of things that appeared to be absolutely intolerable became tolerable. And that just means that there is some margin to play with. And thinking about the cluster of incentives at work and the other forms of groupings that might help. Is something that should be on the agenda. That's about as much as I can.
I don't know if this answers your question exactly. I mean, certainly as race as an abstract category, which creates commensurability among different groups of people, even perhaps different races, you know, clearly that's generated, I think, historically from capitalism, from the abstractions of capital along the lines you're suggesting. But at the same time, I mean, I think you have to be very careful that there's a history, there's an experience of race and racism that are also independent from any types of large, grandiose claims you might want to make for capitalism as a causal determining agent. And I suppose there, to get back to sort of Andrew's presentation, I mean, that's the challenge of sort of the analysis in some respects, to figure out where are the levers politically, legally, perhaps, where we can get at race as a phenomenon and not just have it be, well, it's an abstraction produced by capitalism and we sort of leave it at that.
I just, by way of answering, I think the reason that I lean on federal policy so much is that it's so essential to the process of racialization. Right, it's been, I guess, let me think, about 12 years since Maine Eye's book, Impossible Subjects, looks closely at the Immigration Act of 1965 and says, yeah, this was a great triumph for certain kinds of equalization, but it also put a quota on migration and immigration from Latin America for the first time ever, right? So suddenly, as she, I think, correctly explains, large numbers of people, especially Mexican and brown people, are suddenly sort of placed, in some sense, outside the law. So there's sort of the rhetoric of, okay, we're liberalizing immigration policy, but in fact that wasn't how it worked out. Then, precisely the nature of that law and widespread public ignorance of it allows for a kind of racially innocent anti-immigrant attitude, right? Well, back when my ancestors, et cetera, they weren't illegal. Well, yeah, your ancestors were close enough to white to become white, and there were, since we're talking about European Americans, there were simply no particular restrictions on them, as there would be. So you can say in this, well, this is a matter of law and order, totally ignoring the fact that, well, law and order were completely different depending on what you looked like and when you came. And as far as the policy of it, I think one of the reasons I try to complicate narratives of neoliberalism so much is that neoliberalism hasn't worked out very much for human beings. Right? Capital moves easily, goods move easily, information moves easily. People, not so much.
I want to jump in, but I won't. I'll be third. Bob and you.
I wonder whether Professor Levy could say more about the theoretical connection between exploitation and expulsion in the production of value. Right now, it seems to me that those are presented as dichotomy, and it's not clear how expulsion produces value. But if you think about the production of borders, the creation of frontiers, spreads, and so on and so forth, capitalism actually does create value through producing gaps and spreads and borders and frontiers. And it may be that you need a third concept, the concept of extraction, to explain the role of the relationship between labor that is exploited and the creation of gaps or spreads or frontiers from which investment value is extracted. I'm just wondering whether you know.
Yeah, so extraction, it starts with an E, so I like, you know. That sounds good. I think theoretically, in terms of value creation, there doesn't have to be a distinction between exploitation and expulsion, right? We're trying to ask, when valuation occurs, right, what are the implications in terms of actual people and their relationship with capital? So, of course, exploitation comes from a model of value, understanding of capital, in which the exploitation of wage labor, this is Marx, is absolutely essential. That's where surplus value comes from. You know, the sort of framework I'm moving towards, I think you used the right word, is more of an investment kind of understanding of what capital is, of what capitalization, what gets capitalized. And certain things, when they get capitalized across time, and I realize it sort of begs the question of what moves into what and why, demand, historically, have demanded the incorporation of groups, people, into the economic process as laborers. Laborers, wage laborers, salaried, independent contractors, whatever. So trying to point out where are different moments and why valuation works by drawing people in, as opposed to other types of capitalization, other types of processes that create value, where they do not. And in fact, might actually necessitate kicking people out of that economic space where valuation occurs. You know, that's what I'm trying to get at. But I appreciate the, extraction as another possible sort of mode where this occurs.
God, what a question to Andrew.
After eating.
Okay.
So I have a couple questions for Jonathan and then another one for Professor Wright. For Jonathan, I was wondering about your how you're conceptualizing slavery, and in particular about whether expulsion plays a role there too in a way that you didn't talk about. So the transatlantic slave trade as a form of expulsion of some kind that inaugurates slavery in the Americas, but also your characterization of it as pre-industrial, and that was striking in some ways, because some of the, at least in Black Marxist literatures, there's a way in which slavery prefigures or inaugurates the industrial. And I was wondering about whether that could transform the ways you're thinking about what slavery is doing for you in that period. And then for Professor Wright, the pamphlet you showed us at the beginning tied the fight around public accommodations to the fight around jobs. And so the narrative that followed focused on the fight around public accommodations, and I was just wondering if you could say what happened to the jobs and what was the business interest's response to that part of the demand.
So yeah, these are the right questions. I'll try not to go on at too much length. So I the thing about slaves, conceptualizing slaves. Slaves are many things in a slave society. They are labor, certainly. They're commodities that are, in a sense, consumed. But they are capital. But the thing about a slave as capital is a slave is also a human being. And that's, that's inevitable, right? And so slaves are, in that sense, I think, I think, dual. And so that's where I would distinguish slavery. I call it pre-industrial, but as a distinct form of capital as opposed to factories, you know, which are fixed in space. And second, factories aren't human beings. So I think you have a very different dynamic there, a very different set of issues and a different set of problems in terms of creating value from that form of capital. Now, that would not deny, right, that historically the contributions, when you think of many of them, right, to slavery and initiating the broader history that led towards industrialization. But I do think, so interpretively, analytically, there are ways to keep these distinct without necessarily saying that there's one stage that happens before another, right? They can contribute to whether they can be existing at the same moment in time.
I'll just respond very briefly. I think the direct linkage between public accommodations and demand for jobs, probably only modest. I use that mainly to say, well, they were thinking about larger economic issues. But I think there are a lot of parallels between the two. And my focus is on the southern regional employers. It is so easy to look at the outcome, let's say in the textiles industry, which was an all-white, rapidly growing industry at that time. They desegregated very quickly. The employers resisted that. They were not in Washington lobbying for this act. The EEOC came down to Charlotte, North Carolina to give hearings. They were snubbed. These guys were angry. 4 years later, they're all preaching the doctrine of colorblind racial tolerance because they learned, these black workers, good workers, and we can find ways so that the races can get along. So the way I tell it, I really think the outcome was somewhat that they had to be pushed into seeing something that really was in their interest. And yes, it's important that it was in their interest. Wouldn't it would have been a lot, you know, trying to push something like a race issue against the dead weight of direct profit interest is a real challenge. But if you can get it to line up, as I think it did in the South. So that the economic gains in terms of employment and wage gains were far higher in the South than in other parts of the country. Some of that was catch up because they started out so far along, but it actually has continued. And we have this massive, it may not be quite as massive as the Latin American migration, but the migration of African Americans into the South, ever since the 70s, it's now more than 2 million people. It is really comparable to the Great Depression, to the Great Migration, because the job opportunities seem to be better.
Did you have any questions?
I do have a question, but I think, looming, but so it is. There's, you know, at least some of the talks have presentations focused on the role of the state, role of politics, and tell a complicated, nuanced story about some forms of progress. But I want to sort of think from a demographic view, how much has changed and what has changed and what that tells us about where we are today. So, Andrew, when you part of your talk, you said, you know, that questions of, for example, income and wealth inequality have gotten much, much worse. There are entire spaces in urban areas on the south side of Chicago, west side of Chicago, south central Los Angeles that have been separated from either viable forms of labor or work in any of any sort. There's new types of expulsions that started right after the period that Professor Wright was talking about. Dan Deskin, who was a demographer at Michigan, did a quantitative analysis that showed that the Japanese auto industry put their plants in major metropolitan areas as far as possible from black and Latino centers of population. When he did interviews with the corporate heads of Toyota, Nissan, etc., Honda, they said, oh, the big three told us to do that because you don't want black and brown workers because they're too active. They're too highly unionized and too highly militant in their unionization. So right after the period that we're talking about today, we're seeing blacks and Latinos being moved out of certain forms of high-wage unionized labor. And on top of that, we have an ideology produced by my colleague Richard Epstein, but he's just one of many, that talks about rational discrimination, that talks about it is economically rational to not hire workers of color because of some fictive or presumed difference in productivity. So with new ideologies of neoclassical economics justifying racial expulsions with patterns of racial social, what is the role of politics, social movements, and to ask, put back on the table a question that Levy asked initially, what are the demands that people should be asking for today? Because whatever the demands of the civil rights movement were, they were, or the black power movement for that matter, if they've run their course, they have not. We're talking about different terrain today in terms of the intersection of race, gender, and economics.
I mean, one way that plays out, sort of in your comments, you're in a sense paralleling the black and brown experience of labor. What I found is that it's very different, and that there's a very complex and hugely invidious process of racialization going on that again depends to some extent on the law, right? So that, very roughly speaking, the order is U.S. government policy renders Mexicanos and other brown people legally precarious, therefore easily exploitable. Then that is taken to be a natural condition of, oh, well, you want to hire these Mexicans because they're such good workers. And then rather than it being a parallel with black people, then that becomes a basis to denigrate black people, right? So it's sort of the Mexicans are such good workers. So the idea of a plant not wanting to hire brown or black people, that seems like an older phase in the history, because quite often I've begun to speak with people about hiring in the Kedzie corridor in the 1990s, when there was a specific effort to say, you know, you should be hiring local populations, you know, African Americans and, you know, Mexican Americans, and a lot of the employers said, we just want the Mexicans, right? So that part of what is going on here is rendering one entire population presumptively desirable and another presumptively unemployable. And that then, of course, has outcomes to politics of which you're very, very much aware.
We have time for another question here.
This is mostly for Andrew, but also you, Professor Dawson. Usually the current affairs of capitalism are tied to a rise in another set of political movements, call them what you may, and also the failure of other sorts of movements to deal with that. How do these, be it your populations in Oak Cliff or where you're seeing them, what are they doing and how are they politically thinking, be it consciousness or also just like raw electoral movement, if at all? And this is a question of coalition building, but it's also of, I mean, be it tacit or explicit.
Would you like to, because you know way more about this than I do, I have sort of a follow-up, but I think we'd learn a lot more from you.
How come I don't feel like I know anything anymore? I think what we're seeing, I mean, one of the things that I think that the movements over the last 5 to 10 years, let's say start with Occupy, is the, and I think probably some of your work would reinforce this, we're seeing different combinations in different cities. So there's like a very different history of black and Latino cooperation and conflict, let's say, in New York and Newark than there was. As, I mean, for example, when I went from Chicago to Northern California, I said, what the hell happened? so part of it is the configuration of history, the, you know, local economic terrain, patterns of immigration and migration. In New York, you get various types of ethnic conflict among blacks due to various forms of migration and immigration, et cetera. So that's one answer, is that I think it's hard to generalize because there's a lot of different patterns we're seeing. Second, one of the reliable points of intersection is around policing. So I think you see youth groups and young people and other community grassroots organizers working around prisons and policing is one area that it can be built on, even where some of the other types of coalition. Since the Great Recession, housing, I think, has been, at least in some places, playing a similar role. whether it's renters and or homeowners. We were talking before the panel started about some of the new ways of shell corporations, tax, use of tax liens, predatory appropriation and theft of black and brown property. But it's going to be complicated. And part of the reason it's complicated is that there are middle class elements in all these communities. It's in their interest to use an old-fashioned language, various forms of nationalism that can get away in some of these coalitions that need to be built.
Yeah, just in brief, the pattern seems to be a local competition between black and brown political figures over existing resources, but at the same time, cooperation at the national level, right? So like the Obama coalition and what Hillary Clinton hopes to put together again can simply not happen without African Americans and Latinos voting the same direction. So it's figuring out how to manage the conflicts over who is going to have the ability to dispose of resources locally with their clear common interests at the federal level.
And actually, I think locally, you have to break it down between grassroots, what's going on in communities, versus what's going on among professional politicians.
Right.
And elites, where the competition is intense, and ethnic organizations of that competition is along with the traditional ones. It's not, it's a very good time.
Yeah.